Jesus does not abandon his followers. Through the Holy Spirit, Jesus comes to abide with his disciples of every generation. As Pentecost draws near, we are reminded that the risen Christ dwells in us as the Spirit of truth. We receive the Spirit in baptism and pray that in our gathering around the Lord's table, the Spirit will transform us to be the body of the risen Christ in the world.
Good morning. I'm Hugh Haffenreffer. I'm the pastor of St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Wethersfield, Connecticut. And we are indeed in Wethersfield, Connecticut, or at least I am. I am recording this in our church, in our sanctuary, in this portion known as the chancel, by our paschal candle, standing at our baptismal font. Because these are all reminders of some important truth that we need to take to heart, especially at a time like this of social distancing, which can feel sometimes as spiritual isolation. Today is the sixth Sunday of Easter, and we will hear in a moment that from John's Gospel that Jesus promises his disciples that he will send to them another advocate. It's actually a fancy Greek word, parakletos, which means advocate or helper. Sometimes people refer to it as the paraclete. But that is to back up the earlier promise that he will not leave any of us orphaned, that he will abide with us, accompany us on our journey through life, no matter what that looks like, or whatever hazards we may experience. And I think that's a really important message to take to heart, and one that I'd like to share in a moment. Before we get to that, I'd like to sing a song, and invite you to do so. It's Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. And we'll sing verses 1 and 2. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together our prayer of the day. Almighty and ever-living God, you hold together all things in heaven and on earth. In your great mercy, receive the prayers of all your children, and give to all the world the spirit of your truth and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us hear the word of God by listening to a reading from Acts 17, as well as reciting responsively Psalm 66.
The reading is from Acts in the 17th chapter. In Athens, Paul faces the challenge of proclaiming the gospel to Greeks, who know nothing of either Jewish or Christian traditions. He proclaims that the unknown God whom they worship is the true Lord of heaven and earth, who will judge the world with justice through Jesus, whom God has raised from the dead. A reading from Acts. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, he who is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now He commands all people everywhere to repent, because He has fixed a day on which He will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom He has appointed. And of this He has given assurance to all by raising Him from the dead. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our reading today is the 66th Psalm, verses 8 through 20. Bless our God, you peoples. Let the sound of praise be heard. Our God has kept us among the living, and has not allowed our feet to slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us, just as silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid heavy burdens upon our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and water. But you brought us out into a place of refreshment. I will enter your house with burnt offerings, and will pay you my vows. Those that I promised with my lips, and spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble. I will offer you burnt offerings of fatlings with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats. Come and listen, all you who believe, and I will tell you what God has done for me. I called out to God with my mouth, and praised the Lord with my tongue. If I had cherished evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. But in truth, God has heard me, and has attended to the sound of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld unfailing love from me.
For several weeks now, we have been reading from John's Gospel. And today's reading is part of the final words that Jesus shares with his disciples on the night of his arrest. He encourages obedience to his commandments and promises to send them an advocate, that is, the Holy Spirit, who will be with them forever. The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now Jesus said to his disciples, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. And in a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father. And I will love them. And I will reveal myself to them." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Before we begin our exploration of this text, I think we need to speak with somebody right now, a little guy named Marvin. Here's a moment with Marvin.
What's that? Like old times, Pastor Hugh.
I know, it feels like old times. But I got a question for you. I found this in your room.
Oh, yeah. My wish list.
But it's a bunch of birds. Let me see if I can show the kids. Marvin has a picture of birds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 birds on a stick. How is that a wish list?
Because they each one's a different color.
Oh, I see that. There are different colored birds here. I'll show that again to the children. You see, there's a yellow one, and there's a, what's that, a blue one and a white one. All got different colors here. So this is like a shopping list?
Well, not exactly. I know that I'm going to get one soon.
Well, I know we've talked about getting an animal, like a cat maybe, or something, something small, because you are small. But why a bird?
No, not just any bird.
What kind of bird is this?
It's a Jesus bird.
It's a Jesus bird.
It's a bird that Jesus sends because he said he would.
When did he say that?
Did you not read the gospel?
I did.
Well, you read the wrong translation. But you mentioned it. He's sending us parakeets.
Parakeets?
Parakeets. Can't you pronounce it?
I can. Parakeet. So you're thinking you're going to get one of these, a parakeet.
Yep. And when Jesus promises something, he delivers.
So you think that Jesus is going to send you a parakeet? Well, I have news for you.
Oh, no.
He's not promising to send you a parakeet. He's promising to send the paraclete.
That just doesn't make any sense.
Well, I know it doesn't because comes from a Greek word. And I don't know if you can read the top line because that's actually the Greek. That's difficult. But right below it is how you pronounce it, parakletos. And we sometimes say, in some translation, he promised to send the paraclete. That's kind of the English way of saying parakletos.
Why would you even say that?
Well, because that word means something very important, much more important than a bird that you might pick from a store. It's the promise to send the Holy Spirit to us, the paraclete, or we say the comforter, or the helper, or the advocate.
That's a fancy word, and I don't know what it means.
Well, it means someone who's going to stand with you no matter what, and will look out for you and got your back.
Kind of like you.
Well, in a way, like many of us are for each other. When we are there for each other, we are kind of like a parakletos, a paraclete, the comforter. But in this case, he's referring not just to a person, he's referring to the Holy Spirit.
Oh, that's even better.
That means that God's going to be there. You know why? Because you will never be orphaned.
Oh, I am? Wait a minute. You're not sick, are you?
No, I'm saying you're never going to be orphaned. I'm not sick. I'm not going anywhere. But if I were...
Don't even go there.
If for some reason something happened, you and all of us would never be alone. We will never be without someone who loves us all the time.
And that's who?
Jesus.
Oh.
Through the Holy Spirit, who dwells in your heart. He's going to bring comfort to you and guide you and hold you and never leave you alone.
That's kind of cool.
Well, that's the word for today. It's a paraclete, not a parakeet.
Can I have both?
Well, that we'll have to talk about later. But right now, we want to talk about the Holy Spirit and the paraclete. Paraclete. Very good. How'd you do that?
Open my mouth and words come out.
Good. Thank you. A few moments ago, I shared with you that it is our privilege to be able to read during this few weeks together from John's Gospel. Because we follow a three-year lectionary, we usually, during the course of any particular church year, beginning in Advent, ending on Christ the King Sunday, that during that church year, we tend to focus on one of the three synoptic gospels, either Matthew, Mark, or Luke. And so it's actually kind of rare during the course of the year to be able to have access to John. But during Easter, the Sundays following Easter, the Sundays of Easter, the 50 days, during that period of time, we oftentimes will read from John's gospel. Last week, we began this portion of John by taking a look at a promise that he makes to his disciples that he's going to go ahead of them and prepare a place for them in his Father's house. There are many dwelling places, and he's going to prepare one. And then when he's done that, he's going to come and get them and bring them to himself so that where he is, there you may be also. That's that sense of accompaniment. And there's a lot of rich themes that could come out of last Sunday's gospel, and I hope I explored some of them, but certainly many went untapped. But now there's a sense of rising anxiety, perhaps, on the part of his disciples, especially as he begins talking about leaving them to go somewhere. I remember as a child when my parents would leave for a vacation, leaving us behind, my anxiety level would really go up quite high. That sense of being left alone. I had the experience of being left behind many a times growing up. I was an ADD child, and I can remember in 1967 going to Expo 67 in Montreal, Canada. And as I would sit there and be interested in something, I'd travel one direction and my family, parents and my siblings would all go walking off in another direction, and I'd turn around and look and they'd be gone. And I felt orphaned. And that brought fear to my soul. And then when I heard the voice of my mother, everything was fine. So that sense of being orphaned can run really deep down inside of us. And oftentimes it gets triggered at certain times, at certain events, certain experiences in life, tragedies, change. It's one of those deep down primal needs that each one of us carries with us, I think because we're fashioned in the image of God, to be joined with someone, a community, to be part of a family, to be not alone. And so when the disciples began feeling that sense of urgency that something was about to happen and they were not comfortable with this, it was then that Jesus promised, "I will not leave you orphaned, fatherless, without a family, without means." Especially back then, the idea of being without family and without a father was, it meant you had no standing in the world, especially if you were a woman, most particularly if you were a woman. And so the idea of saying you will always be accompanied, you will always be loved and treasured, you will always be part of something bigger than you, that had to come as a sense of relief to his disciples. And it ought to be we ought to feel that sense of relief ourselves. He promises to send them, and I use that word with Marvin, the paraclete, as opposed to the bird, parakeet. The word parakletos in Greek is a hard one to translate. And if you were to sort of line up all these different translations that you could find in English, you'd find that it's really translated. Some just use the word paraclete. I can remember reading that one time going, I have no idea what that is. Well, who does? And so we have advocate or comforter or helper. None of them really do justice to the word. It is another paraclete, other than Jesus himself, who will come. Then it is the Holy Spirit we're talking about. God dwelling with us. God's breath filling us. God's life animating us. God's power, like a mighty wind, driving us. I will send to you an advocate, a comforter, a paraclete. And you will never be without. I know that many of us, especially times such as this coronavirus pandemic, can feel like the future is uncertain and we don't quite know whether we'll have what it takes to get through it. And I know many of us, and I include myself here, are not all that keen about significant transitions in life, such as retirement, such as ending a ministry and having to separate myself from relationships that I've had for 22 years almost. It can feel as if we're becoming orphaned, cut off, lost, adrift. And that is why this promise of Jesus is so vital. You will never ever be orphaned, because I will always be with you. And once we got that, once we let that truth, the truth of Jesus, the truth of God, abide, dwell within us, feel that love that churns within us when we really take to heart the promise that God makes, that Jesus makes to us. Once we've got that, once that begins to grow like a seed is planted and grows and begins to bear fruit in us and through us, then we now recognize the fact that we've got a message that we really must take beyond these walls, because there are so many people who haven't a clue. They think they're orphaned and the world treats them so. I love, and the reason why I included our first reading today from Acts 17, I love what Paul does there. It's a great lesson plan for preachers. Look around, look at all the symbols that exist, all the things that are important to people, and then pick one and drill down on it. This is what we're going on. The Areopagus is a place, I believe it's outside of Athens, if I'm not mistaken. And it was a place, it was a highly religious area. It was a gathering spot. There was around the Areopagus numbers of statues of various gods that the Romans, the Greeks in this case, worshiped. They were very inclusive with their religion. You know, anyone's god, fine, that's be our god too. But they are also, as philosophers, thinkers, they also seem to want to hedge their bet. Because all these statues here, all these gods that various peoples worship, they can't possibly be the sum total of all the possibilities of God, right? And so they left one spot. I don't know whether it was a pedestal or something, but on it there was a sign that said, "To the unknown God." It's like, you know, making sure that we covered all our bases. You know, we'll preach that one and that one, and we'll worship that one and that one, that one, that one. But, you know, just in case we're missing something, we have that. The unknown God. And Paul comes along and he says, you don't know that God, but we do. And let me tell you about what's missing in your life. Let me tell you about Jesus. We know God is the one in whom we live and move and have our being. Everyone would resonate with that. And that's a wonderful description of God. That's why I wanted to make sure we use this text today. Because think about it. The one in whom we live and move and have our being. It's like we're affirming the reality of God. Even if I'm conscious of God or not, God is always close to me. Someone said to me the other day, they shared with me the idea that saying, boy, you know, if you say to someone, you know, I feel so distant from God, the question becomes, well, then who moved? Because it wasn't God, right? Or it was the Swiss psychotherapist by the name of Carl Jung, who had above his doorway when you went into his home, into his office, and I think it's also at his graveside, a Latin phrase that's basically in English says, bidden or not bidden, God is present. We know deep down inside, whether we know the name of Jesus or not, most people know deep down inside that there is something beyond life. A power greater than ourselves, as the 12-step recovery people refer to it. That is like the one in whom we live and move and have our being. But that can seem so vague, so disjointed, so big, that God has said, I need to give you something specific. And that's what St. Paul does. He stands by this pillar, perhaps, with a sign to the unknown God, and he tells them about Jesus, the one who lived and died so that you and I could have life, the one who promised to send the Holy Spirit to us so that we would never, ever be orphaned or alone, the one who has taken the burden of sin and all the past failures we may have been responsible for and taken them upon himself so that we might feel the unburdening of our souls, the one who will never abandon us. That's the message we bring. However, whatever means we do, whether it's through this medium, or when we finally can restore our connections, person to person, we've got to make sure that story gets told. And I know that story will continue to be told in this place long after I'm gone. You see, it did begin in water, joined to a promise of eternal life and forgiveness of sin and a new fresh start, a new identity. And it was poured out upon us in response to a command to go and baptize. I know that will continue to happen long after I'm gone. I know that the light of Christ's love will burn here long, long after I'm forgotten. And maybe long after this building no longer is here. That reality is eternal. That promise, well, it will never dim. I hope and pray that some of this makes sense. We are not alone. We will never be left orphaned. God is as close to us now as the breath we inhale. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts for our time of prayer. And let the message of this morning sink in as we listen to Morning Has Broken. It's a song by Eleanor Fargeon. It was adapted and made famous by Cat Stevens. And it'll be sung this morning by Alex Cheney.
Morning, blackbird has spoken like
As we prepare for our prayers today, I want to lift up a couple of specific people, families, that are in need of prayers, as they have recently lost loved ones. In the past, we've prayed and for those who mourn the loss of Yasmin, especially her friend Charisma. We prayed for John upon the loss of his mother Joyce. We also last week prayed for our sister Karen upon her passing, and for comfort through the Holy Spirit to be sent to her beloved Daniel and her entire family. We mourn the loss of our beloved David, and we want to continue to lift up his family in our prayers. But this week we also learned of the loss of our sister Betty, and we want to make sure that her family is surrounded by the comfort of our prayers. And so let us pray. Lord God, we know at this time of where life seems upended, and we can feel a sense of anxiety as we face the future. We also know that you send to us your Comforter, the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, that surrounds us with the promise that we will never be alone. And though we are forced to be distant physically from one another, you break through the isolation and you restore our hearts. And so we would ask that you would do precisely that for those who are most in need right now, those who are struggling with health issues or life issues or consequences of decisions they've made or will have to make. We lift up to you Stephanie, Jody, and Janet, Richard and Gloria, Bonnie and Annette, Leanne and Ed, Maureen and Lydia and Joseph, Beverly and Roy, Leslie and Eunice, Marianne and Matthew, Phil and Bob, Rosalie and Ken, Brian, Anne, Kimberly, Monica, and all those for whom we pray either aloud or silently in our hearts, in names known only to you. That they would experience the power and healing of your presence. We pray also for those who have not been able to be in this faith community for some time, who have been restricted to their homes. Especially we pray for Alex and for Larry and for Louise and for Mary, for Dorothy, and for all others whom we name out loud or silently in our hearts. Lord, we also lift up to you our sister Lillian and those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, the family of Yasmin and her friend Charisma, our brother John, as he mourns the loss of Joyce, the family of Karen, especially Daniel, the family of David, and the family of Betty. In the middle of their moment of profound loss and grief, may they be comforted with the promise that mourning may endure the night, but joy will come in the morning. Lord, we lift up to you all those who dedicate their lives to keeping the rest of us safe, and whose service we must never forget. We pray for police officers and firefighters, and those who are in the military and serve the cause of peace. We pray for emergency medical personnel and security experts, hospital staff and caregivers, doctors and nurses and ambulance drivers, those who work in medical research, our elected officials as they seek the right path, those who transport our food, those who grow our food, postal workers who deliver important mail and packages to us, and all those who are part of that web of interconnection that keeps us whole and safe. For all of these, we lift them up to you, knowing that you not only hear our prayer, but you act, and that your grace is sufficient to cover all of our needs. And we pray in the name of Jesus, your Son, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." I would encourage you to stay tuned following this service, for there will be some announcements about decisions, that events, things that are important to know. So I encourage you to stay tuned, stick around. And as we go forth into the world, may the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turning your mourning into dancing. And may Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. Christ is risen, just as he said. Go in peace, share the good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. And let us sing one more hymn, one that I learned when I was very little. Jesus Loves Me, verses 1 and 2.